Local productions on QTV are made possible with support from viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I'm Junia Doan, and this is Uncommon Sense. Thank you for joining us today, and again, I hope. My guest today is Jack Westbrook. Jack is from Mount Pleasant, Michigan, and is the author and editor of several works about Michigan's oil and gas industry. Also just published is his novel, Casa, a story of love, tragedy, and triumph woven around real events in Michigan's past. So, welcome, Jack.
Thank you.
So what got you excited about oil and gas?
Well, it was an exciting subject 50 years ago when I first got involved in the outskirts of the business, because my training by background is in publications. I worked for two advertising agencies, two newspapers, etc. The oil and gas end of things comes more from heritage. My father and grandfather were independent oil producers, explorers in Ohio, who came here in 1932 during the boom. And the other thing that is fascinating, and it's fun to be here, because Mount Pleasant and Midland and the oil and gas industry and Dow Chemical are Siamese twins. They came to be for the same reason, geology.
Mm-hmm.
And I promised you in 60 seconds I was going to make you an expert on Michigan Basin geology. Now here we go.
Okay.
The Michigan Basin is the sedimentary buildup within the remains of an ancient tropical sea. At one time, where we are now was below the equator. As things moved around and things began to settle, sediments and the whole business, the bowl-shaped basin, which basically, on an east-west basis, if you put on your little raincoat and stand at Niagara Falls, that second dark row of rock at the bottom there is the Niagaran formation of the Michigan Basin. If you go to Prairie du Chien, Wisconsin, and you come approach by Mississippi River, the black rock there is a rock from the Michigan Basin. If you go to Ohio, you're not going to see that because it outcrops below the surface. I mean, there's sedimentary buildup. If, however, you go to the Upper Peninsula, you can get out of your car and look up at the rock that we drilled to 15,000 feet at the center. Now, forget all that. Imagine a bowl of raisin bran with the raisins representing oil and gas deposits, the bran representing the containing surrounding earth, mm-hmm, that keeps that raisin in place. Now imagine a bunch of them, like you're mixing bowls at home, shoved one on top of the other. Then take the whole thing, cover it with a mitten-shaped piece of graph paper, take a jeweler's drill, pick a square, and try to hit a raisin. Mm. Now you understand the business. And one other thing that, following that same analogy, is that people often think that seismograph, you'll hear about seismograph being used as an exploration device. Seismograph doesn't tell you, it can tell you that there's something down there that looks like a raisin. Until you drill into it, you don't know whether it's a dry raisin, a salty raisin, or a wet raisin, or no raisin at all. It could be a peanut. You don't know until you drill. So anyway, following that buildup of an ancient tropical sea, Dow Chemical was founded on the basis of the mineral properties of the brine. That's why I've been to the little original plant up here on the river on Main Street. And of course, with that brine is usually an accompaniment of oil and gas. A Dow chemist named James graves, kept seeing all of these, finding oil deposits when they drilled for brine. So he formed, with some other people, the Saginaw Development Company. And previous to that time, there had been a small field, a small well, just a quick spout, and it was done in Saginaw in 1916. The Saginaw Prospecting Company was a group that decided they were going to put some money into finding more oil and gas. They made James Graves the president, and on August 25th of 1925, the first Saginaw field well came in. I helped write a few years ago the historical marker that sits on Weiss Avenue over by the Veterans Hospital in Saginaw, commemorating that first
Graves left Dow to go into business with these other people.
Right. Mm-hmm. Then, as things went on, Dow Chemical opened a salt works in Mount Pleasant on the banks of the Chippewa River, the north end of Mount Pleasant, in 1903. As demand began, and of course World War I, et cetera, came along, people began to look, increasing demand, internal combustion engine, for oil and gas. One of the first geologists, a pure geologist, and the state geologist of Mount Pleasant of Michigan, by the name of R.N. Smith, looked at when you drill a hole, you keep samples. You may have seen well cores before.
Yes.
There's these big tubes of rock that the geologists go crazy over studying. And so they looked at the cores from the Dow wells here and the Dow wells in Mount Pleasant and studied the geology. And usually in the drilling business, the term is the tops, which are the tops of the formations.
Okay.
So if the tops are running higher over here and lower over here, it's a pretty good indication that you're on an anticline this way.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so by comparing these wells, Pure Oil drilled a well. First we'll go to our handy dandy oil field map here.
But still, Wildcat or new wells only come in about 10% of the time.
Certainly.
Right. So
Then as now.
Okay.
I used to have a geophysicist friend who'd say there's been as much oil found with a bent stick as there has from. And I know because my grandfather was a wildcatter. I mean, long before drilling contractors, landmen, all this elaborate stuff, there was the guy who drove down the road and decided this must be the place. See, wildcatter comes from. This is a business of closeology. Somebody finds a well, everybody flocks around it. And the term wildcat in the early days was the guy who would look at all this and would go down this trail among the wildcats and drill a hole. So that is an exploration well. There's two types of wells, exploration and production. Exploration is you're looking for it. Production is you find it, so you're going to develop the reservoir. So anyway, all of this in mind, so there was the Saginaw well in 1925, the Saginaw field discovery, which was a small field. It wasn't a barn burner, but the significance was that you were producing oil. Followed in a couple of years, this got everybody hot and everybody that looked at the geology and the whole business. So they knew that you had this bowl-shaped basin. So they thought, okay, we'll go over here to Muskegon and drill. Bingo. They found another field over there, which was somewhat bigger, a little more productive. Muskegon being a port, they had a way to get it to market and refinery and the whole business. So then the geologist took a look at it for Pure Oil Company and decided, okay, we're going to drill a well midway between Mount Pleasant and Saginaw. Or Mount Pleasant and Saginaw and Midland. So right on the line is where the first discovery was made in 1928. This proved that exploration was possible in the shallower zones in the center of the basin.
So now, really there's production around a lot of Michigan.
64.
Even Midland County you were showing
64
me.
Of 60 of the 68 Lower Peninsula counties.
So it is not a new business here.
It is not a new business.
So people who are now getting interested and concerned about things like fracking need to know what?
Well, they need to know that it's a process. One of the things I don't understand about the new anti-fracking mentality is that the big deal seems to be, okay, they use a lot of water. In the last 5 years, they've gone from recycling 10% of the water they use to 90% of the water. Two, this is deeper wells with bigger reserves and wider reservoirs. Now, if you're going to object to drilling of any kind, and the shallower wells you have to drill close together to accommodate a reservoir, why would you object then to drilling to 10,000 feet, drilling on a 640-acre unit, and having eight fewer wells? It makes no sense to me. Michigan has had 12,000. Nationally, we've had 150,000 wells fracked.
Over a long period of time.
Oh, forever. The first Michigan well was, in fact, you'll find a picture of it in that John Miller book I gave you, of his uncle and another drilling contractor who I knew, by the way, fracking the first well in Allegan County, 1963. So even the people that say, they get all worked up about, well, they tell us it's safe, but what's going to happen 50 years from now? This is 50 years from now.
Right.
And I have set, I started with the Oil and Gas News in 1973, and about every 10 years, we have some kind of a mountain out of a molehill crisis. It started with the Pigeon Rivers. In my experience, it started with the Pigeon River controversy, concern over the elk herd up there, which incidentally was imported here in 1915. They aren't even native to the area. So after 10 years of wrangling the whole business, they drilled in Pigeon River. 2 years later, they had to open a season because the elk population was...
People like to worry.
In fact, if you go to the North Country, one of the biggest problems the industry has is where when they drill and they have an opening for the well, which is usually about 2 or 3 acres, they have deer hunters go lay on top of their tanks to shoot deer because it's open. When you have completed a well, then you replant the area so it's fresh new grass. It's a deer magnet. And one of the primary worries of the industry itself is hunters, because they'll get shooting at a deer or something, and if they shoot a wellhead that is basically has controlled pressure, you could have a real problem. And then who's going to get blamed? The big bad oil industry. So we had Pigeon River, which was nothing. Then we went through a period where private mineral owners, and this was another case, Pigeon River was a case where private mineral owners within the boundaries of the Pigeon River Forest wanted their property developed. Okay. Same thing happened Nordhaus Dunes. There was never going to be any drilling. Michigan has been a hotbed for directional drilling.
Yes.
So, and when directional drilling came here in 73, it was heralded as the environmentalists. It was absolutely wonderful because you can drill you can, from a stationary location here, you can drill as far as a mile out. And
so
below
the
surface.
Talk of water leaking or chemicals leaking in affecting groundwater, and your opinion is?
The only way, there has never been a case of fracking fluids getting to groundwater, not only here, but in the rest of the country. Now there are some other things that, fracking has become the poster child for everything from toothaches to arthritis to an early spring, you know.
Right.
I mean, it just is the mother lode. I saw a headline. In fact, Dr. Timothy Nash from Northwood sent me an article. He and I and the president of Northwood, Keith Pretty.
Yeah.
I knew Keith back when he was Shell's public, or Amoco's public affairs man. But anyway, he sent me an article the other day that was headlined, Group Studies Fracking Impact on Health. And I read the whole article, and the article never mentioned fracking. In fact, it mentioned that one person had said that basically the results of fracking, which is increased production,
right,
fewer wells being drilled, are actually healthier because more people are converting to natural gas from coal,
yes,
for power plants.
Availability and price.
And again, I don't mean to diminish the controversy, because
right. That's
when you get laws and regulations that become insane.
Yes.
In fact, there's a movement afoot in Michigan that if that proposal passed, it'll spell an end to practically any kind of drilling in the state.
Can you speculate why you said every 10 years something happens where people get...
You get a new generation. I mean, it amazes me that here we are at the end of 50 million years of evolution. We have more information available to us.
Yes.
And no less. I mean, you know, one of the things I've heard in the fracking deals is, well, how do we know what's going down that well? There is a website called truthland.com, and there are several others that you can go not only to an area, but a specific well, because it's all regulated by the state. One of the things that you can really be proud to live in Michigan about is that our oil and gas regulation is considered classic. When, as I mentioned, in the 20s, when oil and gas began to grow,
right,
we were still fresh in many people's recent memory of the unbounded harvest of timber, because there was no regulation.
Yes.
It was just slash and run. So as a result of it, our forefathers put together a list of regulations that every move is made. I mean, there have been 51,000 holes drilled in Michigan.
Do you think it's a certain kind of personality that's drawn to wildcatting, or?
Oh, certainly. Certainly.
Well, how would you describe that?
Well, I would describe them as a person who, 83% of the new discoveries made are made by independent producers, not by big corporations.
Oh, I wasn't aware of that. Thank you for sharing that.
This is the guy who, like I said,
says
this is not a bad place. There are tools to aid him now, but the percentages are still the same. But this is a guy who likes to stick his neck out. And the interesting thing is that the independent petroleum producer will invest 120% of his income from the wells, because it's like an addiction. If you stick your neck out, take a risk, and win, then the next hole is going to be the one out there.
Is that your personality?
Mine?
Yeah.
I think so.
Have you ever drilled yourself?
No, but I've done similar things.
Mm-hmm. What?
In 1973, I was working for an ad agency, and the opportunity to take over the only 3-month period that the Oil and Gas News, which is a weekly publication following every well in the state from the time it's permitted to the time it's completed, is the only one of its kind in the country, by the way, in Mount Pleasant. The ad agency I used to work for, the old Oil News, used to farm out the sale of the advertising and their two big issues to the ad agency. So my job, I was familiar with some of these people. As I mentioned, my father and grandfather had come here in 1932, the whole business. So I got to know a lot of these people. Well, in 1973, the Oil and Gas News was sold. So they were looking for somebody to do it. And so my boss at the advertising agency, we sat down, I had the offer made. And he said, well, if you want to take over an out-of-print magazine full of old men that's a dying industry that you know nothing about reporting on, take your chance. So I set
not
up
a
all
big
my
round of enthusiasm there.
Yeah, well, so
maybe
I set
he wanted to keep you as an employee.
Yeah, well, I sat up all night with the thousand piece jigsaw puzzle, and finally decided the next morning, okay, if I don't do this, I'm going to spend the rest of my life wondering about.
What interested you in doing it? What was the temptation? Were you running your own show?
It wasn't exactly running my own show because, you know, I had people to account to too.
Right.
But I'm not a committee person.
Right.
I'm not an organization person. I never have. I mean, you know, if you got to get permission from three men and a boy to do something, and this was a weekly publication that I was solely responsible.
So you had to go generate news, make relationships.
Well, I didn't have to generate it. I had to go
find it, report it.
Well, I always said our business was to go where you may not have the inclination to do, find out what you want to know, and deliver it to you for a couple bucks a week. And so basically I kind of share the same mentality.
Take the risk.
The risks are great, the rewards are great. The risks are, you know, it's like Hollywood and Vine. There's a million perspective.
Were you married at the time?
Oh, yes.
And what did your wife say about that?
Well,
that risk.
She was fairly used to it.
Oh, what else had you done?
Well, I had got bright eyes for starting my own printing and promotion business right before the great repression of 1969. I had done a number of things, including military service from high school. And with each one, I found out, well, some I didn't like, some of them I liked better, but I also, it just didn't find the fit. It's like Thomas Edison said when they asked him what happened. I was a resume mess because I had 13 jobs in 10 years because I did everything from fill newspaper or fill candy machines to deliver newspapers and everything else. But when it clicked, it worked. And that's one of the things about the new book. My character, Chiesa,
yes,
who's the child of a Dutch school teacher and a copper miner, she makes her decisions the same way. Somebody asked her.
Oh, with feeling?
Yes.
Rather than head?
Well, both. It's just kind of an instinct.
Uh-huh. That,
because somebody who read this book said, well, there's an awful lot of life changing in a day or a week in there. I said, yeah. Most of the things that happened to her come from experiences that we've had in our married life.
I love it. Now, I understand you help other people write their autobiographies.
Yep.
Do you get into their voice or to their heads or
well, in
their
one
speech
case,
pattern?
In one case, a good friend of mine who was really is really legend in the oil and gas industry, C. John Miller, he called me up one day and he says, well, he says, I always like the stuff you've done. And he says, I want to kind of put together a book to tell my grandkids what I did. And I said, well, I hope you find somebody because anybody can sit down and do that. But I spent 28 years reporting on this industry. I know the history. And you owe it, you don't owe it just to your grandkids to say, this is what granddad did. You owe it to every guy who's out there drilling a hole, maybe skipping meals to find a length of pipe. You owe it to them to say, tell them that you weren't always John Miller. So there's a chance there.
For everyone.
For everyone.
I have to thank you. because we're out of time, but I want to say I've learned a lot about you. Live your passion, take your risks, whether it's oil or a job, and don't be afraid of changing jobs. Maintain, understand there are different kinds of people, and find the kinds of people you want to be with, doing the kinds of things. Build up a specialty, very important, and have great memory, you have a wonderful memory, great memory and interest about things, and have an ability to share and connect. And so the ability to write autobiography is enhanced because he knows the industry, he knows everything. So those of you who are thinking about writing your autobiography and getting someone to help you, don't. Find someone who's an expert in the field. And as I say to all of you all the time, you know, this is the chance to make our community better. And so go out and do something nice for someone you know and someone you don't know, and do it every single day. And, you know, courage, friends. This is a great life, and we should live it full out. See you next time.
To contact Junia, send her an email at info@juniadone.com. For more information, program schedules, and news about future guests, go to www.juniadone.com. Thanks for joining us. See you next time for Uncommon Sense with Junia Doan.
Local productions on QTV are made possible with support from viewers like you. Thank you.